Relations Committee.
Well, good evening. Thank you for having me this evening. And with nearly 200 countries across the globe, there's no shortage of important issues which need the attention and leadership of the United States of America. The world is bearing witness to the most substantial strategic realignment of great powers since the beginning of the Cold War. And at the same time, people around the world are losing faith in the institutions of their governments. There are some here today who criticize current U.S. foreign policy and leadership, but the current international landscape is not the same one that many of us are accustomed to. And therefore, before we can philosophize on what should be done next, we should understand how we got here. Today, for the first time in a generation, the world has seen the reemergence of substantial competitors in every major region in the world, including Asia, Europe, and the Middle East. These competitors are willing, and most importantly, able to compete against the United States, and this competition threatens to disrupt the world order that America and our allies created in the aftermath of World War II. That world order, without a doubt, benefited everyone, but especially those who believe in the principles of democracy, human rights, the rule of law, free markets, and free trade. These cornerstones of liberty and prosperity are once again under assault as we face global competition from a China that desires to be more than a regional power and a resurgent Russia that wants to regain the influence it enjoyed during the height of the Cold War. At the same time, rogue states like Iran and North Korea continue to challenge stability in their regions. Collectively, this is an outcome that U.S. foreign policy has always aimed to prevent as part of our strategic outlook. Of all these challenges, China is the most significant and consequential to the future of the United States. Unlike Russia or Iran, China presents a truly global challenge. President Xi and the Chinese Communist Party operate with a few goals that we need to recognize and focus on. First, they are in constant pursuit of total control at home to ensure the continued rule of the Communist Party. Second, they aim to displace the United States in Asia and secure a position as the preeminent power in the region. Third, they seek deep influence in every other region of the world so China can steer the economic and political decision-making of other nations in its favor. Together, these goals present a multifaceted challenge to the United States. There is a lot we have to do to counter Chinese behavior, but a good place to start is calling the attention to the Chinese Communist Party's broken commitments, and you can find ample examples throughout China's domestic and foreign policy. I'll start with the economic realm. In 2001, Western nations helped China enter into the World Trade Organization with the belief that free trade and economic development would encourage China to become a responsible member of the international community. 18 years later, it is plain to see that is not the case. Year after year, the U.S. Trade Representative highlights China's failure to protect intellectual property rights, its continued forced technology transfers from U.S. companies, and its refusal to open certain sectors of its economy despite previous promises that it would do so. A timely and incredibly pressing example of Chinese Communist Party's broken commitments is the current situation in Hong Kong. In 1997, when China regained sovereignty over Hong Kong, it promised that Hong Kong would maintain a high degree of autonomy. That was not just a verbal understanding, it is a promise China made when it signed an international treaty with Great Britain in 1984. But since 1997, China has gradually chipped away at that autonomy. The protests we have seen this summer reflect years of frustration by the Hong Kong people, who are seeing an evaporation of the rights and freedoms that they were promised. We should all care about what is happening there. A country that breaks its promise to its own people will certainly not treat its international partners any better. Last week, I met with Joshua Wong and several other advocates who are bravely pursuing Hong Kong's autonomy and democracy. I told them that the U.S. Congress will do all it can to help them. As chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, I have overseen the preparation of bipartisan legislation that supports the people of Hong Kong. We are voting on this bill in the committee this week, and I'm optimistic that we can move this legislation on the Senate floor in short order. Hong Kong is just one example of how vital U.S. leadership is to the world and the contrast between American and Chinese leadership. American leadership not only secures our national interests, but has the added benefit of lifting up millions, indeed billions, of people worldwide. Chinese leadership is focused solely on the benefits of the Chinese Communist Party. In Hong Kong, China has shown that there is no room for legitimate aspirations of its people. And earlier this month, here at the UN, China threatened to veto the continuation of the U.S. mission in Afghanistan unless the resolution praised its signature One Belt, One Road initiative. In a far more competitive and unstable world, it is critical that the United States continue to sharpen the competitive edge we need this new century, and that includes supporting and relying on our allies to make our team stronger. Let's be clear and proud. The United States does not dominate the international system to enrich itself. We work to lead the international system so that any country can prosper, develop, and live better. This is not true of our competitors. It is precisely the robust debates in American politics that help produce policies that sustain our democracy and our foreign policy. The Senate Foreign Relations Committee is made up of 22 senators, and each of us is unique in our schools of thought and approach to U.S. foreign policy. We have some issues on which we disagree, but historically and still today, we agree on the most important issues, and those center around the principles we have talked about today: democracy, human rights, rule of law, free markets, and free trade. These common principles and our commitment to serving our truly historic democracy unifies us and will sustain us for years to come. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak with you today. Thank you. God bless you all.